So the first part of the surgery was to relieve that pressure by opening up the scalp and actually performing a window in the bone. Here's the, the edge of the bone here. This is what we call a craniotomy, and in this case it's a craniectomy because we took the bone off and left it off. And then something caught my attention at the corner of my eye when I was doing this surgery. I saw something here. It wasn't kryptonite green like this, unfortunately, but it did look abnormal. So we started to remove that tissue, and at the base of it, there was the blood clot that we saw on his CAT scan. So to kind of piece the puzzle pieces together, the chicken and the egg scenario was that he had a tumor that was hiding, and it bled, it caused some bleeding, and this is the blood clot. And both of those things combined caused the swelling in his brain. The next view is the surgery where we went back to finally tackle the last bits of this tumor. One thing I didn't tell you is that it's tucked away in there. You know, you can barely see the whole tumor, and there's some very important stuff back there. Important, there's a structure called the superior sagittal sinus. That's the main way out for the blood at the top of your head, top of your brain. I can't see that. It's hidden from me. And I always had this thought as I was preparing for surgeries in the past, man, if only I could shrink myself down to really itty bitty size and fly my way in. So what you can do now with VR technology is you have the ability to take a walk, immerse yourself into the anatomy in three dimensions, and remember, you are in this space, this three-dimensional space. So now I'm actually standing inside of Mathias' brain. I'm going to look over my shoulder, and lo and behold, I can see the tumor in great detail now. And what I couldn't appreciate on his two-dimensional images was that there was this huge pipe going through it. So his tumor had actually wrapped around that superior sagittal sinus the way that I was worried about. And if I had chased it that first surgery, we could have really hurt him. So I have a little bit of fun for you guys now. So I've been your tour guide, but with the price of admission, you get to walk around the museum on your own now.
And are the blue and the yellow that we see each other's avatars? Is that us walking
correct.
Around?
And I'm gonna just zoom out a little bit here. Okay.
Oh my gosh.
Superman.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah.
And I love that it even has the anatomy labeled so you can orient yourself.
Yeah, so I put a little bit of a scavenger hunt here for you guys to bring you back to day four of medical school. some important anatomy is where does your motor and sensory cortex live? Where do your speech centers, your Wernicke's area, and your Broca's live? There's actually vision tucked away back behind the tumor. You are welcome with your hand controllers now. Your left thumb controls forward and back, so if you push the left thumb joystick forward and up, you'll fly in, and then you can use the right joystick to look right and left. But you know, remind yourself, your head is a joystick too, so you can look around all you want and see different things just with your head movements.
This is truly remarkable.
Yeah. It's fantastic. So
are you there, Superman?
Yeah. Is this only available in neurosurgery now? Are there other areas where?
No, not at all. Any situation where you have a two-dimensional set of images that you want to reconstruct a three-dimensional image is applicable for this device.
Wow, I see so many applications with microsurgery, with ear surgery, eye surgery.
But let me ask you, in terms of the more emergent surgeries, how using this technology, in Mathias' case, this was after the initial surgeries, how long does it take to set up this virtual reality model? In other words, as you mentioned, that tumor is in such a position that you had to be very careful with the surgery you planned. Yeah. If a surgery were a little more emergent, how long does it take to get all of this set up, if you will?
To build a case, to go from 2D to 3D, takes about 20 minutes. I wish I could get my patient from the scanner to the OR
that
in 20 minutes.
That is remarkable, because I was thinking days and days.
20 minutes.
So this truly could have emergent applications.
At some point, you could
literally have a patient in the emergency department and have an emergent situation. You need to plan the brain surgery right then and there. What's the best way to do it? And by the time you're in the OR, could be using virtual reality.
Absolutely. I mean, I hope that by the end of my career, we'll look back and think, well, how do we ever take care of these patients without the use of VR in these emergent situations? It's quick.
Even if there's a fracture or a bony, any, it doesn't even have to be a tumor. I mean, it certainly could be any sort of traumatic situation where you're just trying to model that reconstruction.
Yeah, and you know, we really are at the ground floor of this. So we're just now understanding what the boundaries are and how far we can take it. So it's an exciting time.
Yeah. And Mathias, I want to say thank you so much for letting us go on that journey with you.
Well, of course.
How are you doing overall right now?
Okay, so I'm doing great. I mean, I'm running again, and I'm doing everything I was able to do before. I mean, it's amazing what he was able to do with the VR. I mean, It's been a great experience.